I'm a forensic clinician, and I work with the National Police Service. And every day I see about 40 to 60 victims of violence, confused, desperate victims of violence.
I am Kizzy Shako, better known as Dr. Kizzy Shako. I am a mother of two lovely children. I'm a human rights defender, something I take very seriously and I'm very passionate about. And one of my main missions in life is to strengthen the criminal justice system in the country and hopefully beyond. I am also a forensic medical practitioner, also known as a police surgeon or police doctor. And my area of expertise is in the aspect that refers to the living injured or addresses the living injured. And what I do is collect evidence and information, usually for the police, because these cases tend to be criminal matters, and I present them in court as an expert witness, in a nutshell.
Defilement being the rape of a child. A child is a minor under the age of 18.
When I started working as a police surgeon, I realized that there was a large number of complainants or victims who were, you know, assaulted within the home, domestic violence, and an even larger, more disturbing number were children. So in a day, I would see about 10 to 20 victims of domestic violence, usually women, and about a year or two ago, it was now 10 to 15 child victims of sexual abuse. And most of those would be females. So my work is about also defending such the rights of the vulnerable in terms of whether it's male or female, but usually the bulk of them are women. And I'm explaining this because men tend to think they've been sidelined or anything, we're picking on them as perpetrators. But the truth is that most victims are females and most perpetrators are males. This is a fact that you can find anywhere. Now, I am very passionate about helping victims of domestic violence and sexual violence because I find it's an area that is really misunderstood. And when I joined, it was really literally not known very well. How it should be dealt with, who should handle it, what's the procedure, what are you supposed to do? And the worst part is I'd find victims come to have the P3 form completed, filled, so I examine them and document on a P3, and then they have to take that back to the police station. But almost all of them didn't know what they were doing there, why they were there, where they were going next, to who, what to expect, what was done, why it was done. They're just, you know, go to that office and they follow, not knowing why they are doing it. And that's an insult on top of something that has already happened that's really terrible. So I decided to educate the general public as much as I can on the procedures and the processes that are required and the dynamics that result in some of these assaults taking place. And that's what gave birth to an organization I call Vunja Kimya Foundation, because it's about breaking the silence. The reason I said this is because I tried reaching out to several people who have access to platforms that can address millions, but there was not much interest in getting such information out. So I started writing articles to get this information out through a website, vunjakimya.com. That was just the starting point, and now it's a registered NGO, non-government organization. On top of all this, you know, all these dynamics that are misunderstood, like what is it that, why is it that women end up in these situations? What is it about the environment or the individuals or the males or the females or the children or the, you know, our culture, our tradition? What is it that is promoting violence within our society? And I also learned that while doing this research, I found out that those who fought back, put up a fight. Not everyone can put up a fight, but you can learn to put up a fight. So some of the women I would meet actually fought back and managed to flee from the impending assault that was coming their way. And so I read up more on self-defense. At the same time, I met someone who is a self-defense instructor, among other things. And he was talking about how important it is for women to be able to defend themselves. And I met one or two others. One is called Emily as well. She really we together collectively teach women about the need to take on self-defense lessons, to equip ourselves with techniques that can help us to escape certain environments. And you're taught the kind of environment or situation or scenario that you should fight back. You can fight with your voice, or you can fight by doing certain things, or sometimes you just give in. You have to know when to do what for the best outcome. And you know, studies show that women who have these kind of skills and techniques actually are at a 30% lower risk of being assaulted in future. Yeah. So I thought that was really important because it boosts confidence, and in the event that you need to do something to protect yourself, you're able to. In my field of work, you know, I'm a relatively young female, one of the first in my field, and then everyone else is like male. And so there's all this back and forth, pushing and fighting for your space in the field, you know, and to create boundaries and to explain that, you know, I need to be respected, and my field of expertise needs to be respected just as yours is. Don't look at me as a girl. I'm actually a grown woman who has the education and skills required to fulfill the work at hand. That's what we should be talking about, you know? And so because of this, there was a period when I felt very, confidence was a problem. Let's just say that. So now when I find that something little, to me this is a very small thing that I'm doing to help another person navigate their lives and get better, and they come back and say, thank you so much, that really helped me, you understand me so well, no one else has understood, you know, things like this. I didn't know what I was doing or where to go, you gave me, you know, you pointed me in the right direction. This is extremely rewarding beyond any, I can't even put it in words, I realized that there's a gap that needs to be filled, and I decided I would step in and try and fill that gap as I convince others to join in this fight to fill the gap together. And so there has been a lot of impact, positive impact, some little negative, but more on the positive.
For me, it's just a Tuesday or a Wednesday or a Friday. For the victims, it's the worst day of their lives.
The first thing I'd like to say is that there's this misconception that when there's a violent act that happens in the neighbor's house, that's their business. If your colleague is, you know, shows up with a black eye, it's her problem. If, you know, that child, you know, is being abused, you hear the child crying every day, in a weird way, and your gut tells you there's something wrong, I should check and find out what's going on, but I don't want to upset anyone. When we ignore these things, what we are doing is we're actually allowing this kind of behavior to proceed. We are creating a conducive environment for perpetration of violence, and that isn't our problem. It's our collective problem, because if we have a generation of children growing up in a violent environment, then they're going to grow up and become teens and then adults, and you'll still be here, and you'll also have children who will mingle with these same children. So it's our business, it's your business to ensure that the children where you are protected. It's my business to do the same. And so we all have to take responsibility of our environment by ensuring that we do our part, our best, to make sure that it's a safe place for people to live, and more so safe for children to grow. Over the years, my typical day has changed. It's very dynamic. So initially, my typical day as a police doctor was I'd go to the office and find like numerous people waiting, you know, very many, like I'm talking in the hundreds, and then sit down and examine them, or even see 80, 100 a day. and then at the end of the day go home. Then eventually that would, the day work would include going to court as well, because 100 cases that you're examining is 100 potential court cases. If you're seeing 12 rape cases a day, those are 12 court cases in one day. So just in a month, you're talking 100, you know. So a lot of my work for the longest time has been court work and examining of victims and suspects of these kinds of assaults. I also teach a lot. I am a trainer in forensic evidence management, especially for sexual violence cases. This is because sexual violence is complicated and has a lot of different kinds of dynamics that need to be taken into place, different factors that need to be accounted for, and because the medical personnel, actually the gaps we have are cross-cutting. So it's from community level, police level, medical level, and even in the judiciary and the prosecution, because there are certain things that are completely and totally misunderstood, which have a very heavy impact on the outcome of a trial for the suspect, for the victim. So I do a lot of training on this so that there's better understanding for all these different stakeholders.